さん入れない。
あ、じゃあそうなのか。で、ちょっと、日本語しますけど、篠田さんから聞くと、今日6時からレセプションがあって、ランの発表は5時に終わる予定なんですけども、レセプションはもう上でやるので、まあ、バッファーが1時間ぐらいあるということで、まあ、急いでプレゼンテーションしてもらえるよう、まあ、ゆっくりしてもらった方がいいと思うので、まあ、とりあえず、みんなが眠くなる、はい、まあ、5時45分ぐらいまでですかね。
はい、まあ、私、ダウンの疲れとかもある
まあ1時間程度で一旦区切って、45分ぐらいで区切りながらこう行くとちょうどいいかもしれない。
So I think, you know, that officially we announced that our end of this seminar is 5 o'clock today, but our dinner starts 6 o'clock in this building, so just we can think about, you know, if you're tired or not, or just you got many questions. Maybe you will stop in the middle of this topic, so maybe you can take your time and many questions.
Okay, yeah, I plan, I don't think I'll get through this whole talk today. So,
so let's start from the questions and answers on the first part.
Through your presentation, you showed some common question which emerged when some normalization applied. So, have you tried to be a methodology to high or slow?
To normalize high or slow?
Yes.
No, I haven't done that. What would you mean by like normalizing it? So like, What would one be? What would you normalize by? Like a single storm, and then all storms are relative to that storm? Or
normalized by RMW.
Oh, you're saying like normalize the RMW.
Yes.
I don't think I've done that before. But I think it would just give you a similar picture. Because like, so this is a function of physical RMW, because it's a linear relationship, which is easier to see if you look at the momentum surface. It's a much clearer, less scattered linear relationship. If you picked some RMW to normalize all the other RMWs by, it would scale in the same way. So I think you would probably just get a similar result where you have a linear increase in the slope of the RMW with the size of the roll-up bar.
Can I get that
た
ぶんだから大野さんが言ってるのはここのことですね。RMW に議論の
to calculate the slope in this way?
Right. Over some, you know, 6 kilometers.
Oh, you're saying so.
This is our normalization, kind of. Or maybe you can use the middle.
So I mean, like what I did, like essentially, I mean, I used like the best fit line to the RMW in each case. So whatever the linear approximation to this RMW and that slope. And so that would be similar to just taking the endpoints, like the 8 kilometer minus the 2 kilometer RMW and dividing by the vertical depth. And so that would be like this numerator here. But you're saying to divide by this. So then this is a different quantity now. You're
right,
saying
right.
divide. So this, I mean, like then physically, this would not dimension. And then so if you divide by delta z, then it like that's like different quantity than the slope. But I don't know. I don't have a sense of what that would do. Why do you think that would be useful to look at? Like, what do you think that would tell us?
I believe the shape of the arrow is related to the intensity and in my previous work, I proposed a parameter which characterizes the arrow shape and I got a result which shows the shape of the eyeball related to the intensity.
Oh, I think I read your paper recently. Yeah. So you found that there was a relationship with intensity of the slope.
I did.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess I could do that with the observations easily. I haven't. I don't know. I'm not sure what that would show. I have to like read over your paper more carefully to think about what that would mean. That's something I'll look into. I don't have a good sense of what it would look like in the observations right now, but that's something I can look into.
Could you please show me the last slide about the contraction and the relationship between the contraction and the wind speed?
This one?
Star 2015. Previous.
That one?
I'm wondering, first of all, I like the Star Network 2015 very much.
Oh, okay.
I'm really interested in the intensification processes without any radius of maximum wind speed contraction.
Mm-hmm.
So what makes the rapid intensification without ion contraction?
What makes it happen?
The mechanism for the rapid
intensification. I think the mechanism is the same. I think it's that you don't really need, like contraction happens with rapid intensification some of the time, and then particularly the early part of rapid intensification. But I guess I don't think that the contraction itself is critical. It's not necessary for the rapid intensification to occur. It's sort of like a byproduct because you tend to have when the storm is weak and the profile is less sharply peaked, you have you're able to rapidly contract when you have wind tendencies that are maximized inside the RMW. So the RMW can rapidly propagate inwards, and this is happening. And you're also increasing the wind speed rapidly. But once you get the moderate strong storm, when it becomes sharp enough, you stop contracting. But you're still having angular momentum advection. Like the same processes are happening that were happening when it was weak. You still have heating that's located inside or at the RMW that's driving the secondary circulation through like the processes that you would represent in a Sawyer-Eliasson model or something like that. And so you get strong inflow in the boundary layer, and angular momentum is increasing at any given point in that region, and so your wind speed is increasing. So the wind speed is just increasing most rapidly, either at the RMW, or if it's increasing rapidly inside the RMW, the winds are falling off so sharply that the RMW can't propagate. But what matters for the intensity change is just the angular momentum advection, which still happens just as well. So I guess I would argue that you don't really have a different physical reason for rapid intensification. The same conditions are there by just having deep convection in a storm that is
that is not at its potential intensity, so you can still intensify, and that process will just continue as long as you don't have negative environmental factors.
Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering, what to see the intensification?
What stops the intensification?
For example, the blue one and the black one.
I mean, from like a potential intensity theory perspective, mm-hmm. you've reached the peak intensity that you can support thermodynamically for your enthalpy sources from the ocean, from like your sea surface temperature, and then like from like an energy balance perspective, your frictional dissipation is increasing so that it's increasing so that it outweighs or equals the energy that you're gaining from surface heat fluxes. So when you reach that balance, then you no longer intensify. Or from like the Sawyer-Eliasson perspective, if you're in a steady state, then you still have strong inflow and you're tending to bring angular momentum inwards, but your friction is dissipating the angular momentum, so it stays at any given physical radius. You're not changing your angular momentum anymore because the friction is balancing the radial advection. Mm-hmm. And so that sort of determines when it stops intensifying in that sense. Mm-hmm.
So the last one. Regarding this point, how about the effect of increasing natural solubility?
Increasing inertial stability?
Yeah. So I understand that peak shape is important for the top of RW interaction. But this is a perspective of diagnosis of RW. But
yep.
If we can understand this process physically, from the perspective of physical processes,
uh-huh.
inertial stability, the magnitude of inertial stability also affects the contraction speed of RNL. Is it right? For example, recent Jeff Kepler's paper says inertial stability also affects the magnitude of inflow strength.
Yes.
This affects the radial rotational convection
yes.
side are in the, and those processes affect the conjunction also
yes.
affect the conjunction speed the timing of the conjunction are the conjunction stops. I was wondering such a thing how about
so you're wondering how that those ideas relate to this?
Yeah.
I mean, I think they do. I think yeah. I like Jeff Kepler's recent paper a lot about the discussion of where the convergence in the boundary layer should be and how that changes with the size of the storm and the inertial stability. And so he found that when you have a larger radius of maximum winds, you have stronger inflow and you have a greater overshoot of the peak convergence to where the Iowa updraft would form would be further displaced inwards of your RMW for the larger storms, and that as you get smaller and smaller, the amount by which the updraft is displaced inwards becomes smaller, and we get the Iowa updraft closer to the radius of maximum wind. So I think that I think that probably relates a lot to the numerator term here, where your tendency of tangential wind that you get from your radial advection of angular momentum from the secondary circulation. That could relate to why that I think that's another reason why physically you could get rapid contraction when the storm is large
So I don't think his perspective is in conflict with this. I think they both are kind of different ways of describing why contraction happens rapidly when it's a large storm. So his relates more to like the structure of the tendency changes, but I'm arguing that that as the curvature becomes large, that'll also systematically change the rate of contraction. But I think more can be done. Like I'm interested in kind of further exploring how Jeff's recent work also relates to the contraction of the RMW and how we can integrate these perspectives. I think they're connected.
Okay, thank you. If you have any further questions, please ask. Enjoy the reception and tomorrow. So please go to the next further questions.
Okay. Let's get a little more liquid. No sucking.
No sucking.
Later. After 6 o'clock. You better to bring a full bottle.
But I don't want to drink the whole bottle. I want to make sure I don't do that. Okay. So I don't plan to finish this lecture today, so at some point it'll probably be a good time to stop, and if you feel like it's the right time, just let me know.
Well, you can decide when you start.
Well, then I just might keep speaking forever. let's see, what's this place? So this lecture is about the tropical cyclone warm core and what we know about it today, the previous research about the structure and the warm core and how it relates to other aspects of the storm, and some of the work that I've done and some other people have done, revisiting old observations and trying to get a refined sense of what the warm core structure is. So this is the same photo I showed in the previous talk. So it's the eye of Hurricane Katrina near peak intensity. So this is also when the storm is going to have the warmest temperatures in the eye. So the eye is warm and dry above the boundary layer. These are boundary layer clouds driven by weak frictional convergence in the eye. They're shallow, planes flying at about 2 kilometers. So these clouds are about a kilometer and a half cloud tops. So at this point, there's an inversion in the boundary layer. The temperature increases with height, and this whole area here that's clear is very warm, and it's the warmest air anywhere on Earth in the middle and upper troposphere. So I'd like to start out with this schematic from this paper by Hugh Willoughby in Monthly Weather Review in 1998, just sketching the structure of the eyewall and eye, and the physical processes that we believe contribute to the warming of the eye. So this just shows this outward sloping eyewall updraft that we talked about in the last talk, which is fed by frictional inflow, as well as deep inflow that's driven by the eyewall heating itself. So this is the secondary circulation. And then inside of the eyewall updraft, you have descent. I'll show you a little later, like at the inner edge of the eyewall where it meets the eye, you have strong descent that's also mixed with precipitation, nearly saturated, and so you get evaporative cooling there. But as you get further away from the eyewall, you get away from the precipitation and you have dry descent subsidence. That is forced by the convection in the eyewall through the secondary circulation. And just like that photo I just showed you, where the cloud tops are in the eye, there you have the inversion, and the inversion is the base of the layer where you have the subsidence. And then you tend to have weak outflow in the low-level eye, which also feeds into the eyewall. So the theme of this lecture is that the main cause of the warming of the eye is subsidence that's ultimately forced by the convection in the eye wall. So this is another way of looking at this same idea. This is just to show what it looks like in an idealized simulation. This is the same idealized simulation that I was showing you throughout the previous talk. And so here we're kind of zoomed in on the inner core. This is the azimuthal mean tangential wind, the radius of maximum wind here, about 30 kilometers at low levels. This is the outward sloping eye wall. The red line contour is the 1 meter per second mean eye wall updraft, and it slopes outward with height. And the magenta arrows here, this is the secondary circulation, the radial and vertical flow. Again, this is an azimuthal mean, and it's also a time mean. And I've blocked out the vectors in the eye wall because they're so much stronger than those in the eye. The eye wall would have vertical velocities in the mean on the order of 2 to 5 meters per second, and the vertical velocities in the eye are much weaker. And so these are in the order of centimeters per second here. The point of this slide is to show that inside the eye wall, you systematically have a descending flow. And so that's going to where it's subsaturated, which is almost all of the eye, it's not near saturation. You're going to dry and you're going to warm the eye through this descent. And ultimately, it's the vertical distribution of the descent combined with the vertical distribution of the static stability is going to determine how much the eye warms and where it warms.
So, could you tell me, where is the boundary of a cloud?
The boundary of what?
Boundary of cloud.
Cloud?
Yeah.
I don't have it here, but it's going to be very close to where this line is.
So actually,
this is 10 centimeters per
second. Red contour means the contour of vertical motion?
Yeah, sorry. So this, I said 1 meter per second, but this is actually 10 centimeters per second.
Centimeter. Mm-hmm.
So inside of here is a 1 meter per second updraft somewhere, but this is sort of the boundary of any significant vertical motion in the eye wall. So if I plotted the cloud water field, it would pretty closely align with this contour. So basically everything inside of here, and you can see we have descent here, so it's hard to sustain a cloud where there's descending air. So the cloud boundary is basically the same as this inner contour of the vertical velocity.
So is the descending motion is stronger in near the eyeball boundary than the descending motion in that typhoon center?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I'll show that later, maybe today, maybe tomorrow. Mm-hmm. I have a figure with the mean structure of the vertical motion in the eye as a function of time during the storm. So you'll see, and you can see here, the arrow, the vectors are longer near the eye wall. So the strongest descent is right along the inner edge of the eye wall.
What causes the downward motion outside the eye?
I think there's a couple things that contribute to it. There is evaporation and there's melting, and that's going to drive descent there. But you're also driving descent from for the same mechanism that's giving descent in the eye. So the secondary circulation, the vertical motion in the eye is forcing descent on the other side of the eye wall as well. So you get descent on the inside of the eye wall and descent on the outside. So some of the descent on the outside of the eye wall is driven by the convective heating in the eye wall, but there's also a contribution from the evaporative cooling itself in this region here, because you have a very heavy rainfall. And actually, in simulations, the descent here outside of the eye wall tends to be actually even stronger than the descent that you get in this zone here on the inner edge of the eyewall. So this is the actually tends to be the most significant descending growth curves in that region. But because it's nearly saturated and there's lots of rain and snow and gravel, you're not you're not driving warming from that descent. So as a consequence of that descent, as I said, you get adiabatic warming in the regions where it's subsaturated, and so that's the eye. Here, the eyewall updraft, so this is a horizontal cross-section, I should say, at a temperature at 6 kilometers from this idealized simulation. So this is in the middle of the troposphere. And so this is actual temperature in degrees Celsius. And then the eyewall vertical motion field is given by this white contour. So what you can see is that the eye is much warmer than its environment. Here the eye is 8 degrees Celsius in the center, and the far field environment is more like negative 8. So you have a perturbation in the temperature of about 16 degrees here, and which is consistent with the fact that the simulation is showing a very intense storm. Equivalent to category 5. So the temperature in this case, and in many cases, is maximized at the center. So, and that's consistent with hydrostatically, that's where your lowest surface pressure is. And you can also see that the vast majority of the warming in the hurricane is inside of the radius of maximum winds. So you have this slow increase in temperature as you go toward the center, although you tend to have a little bit of cooling right near the RMW. And then in the eye wall, you get some amount of warming from the strong diabatic heating from condensation in the eye wall, but that's largely offset, as I'll show, by vertical advection, by the adiabatic cooling that you get from the ascent. So you get a small amount of warming in the eye wall, but almost the vast majority of warming is inside the eye. And as we'll show, that's forced mostly by the subsidence. And so associated with this very strong warming, you have a very sharp radial temperature gradient, which is negative, so the temperature is decreasing outwards.
It's okay. So maybe just I'd like to see if you have the potential temperature map. Maybe very similar to that, but a difference in a pressure field, a little bit different than that. So I'd like to see how much impact comes from the pressure.
It's mostly from the temperature.
Right.
I think it would be some slightly larger magnitude if you did it in potential temperature. I have a potential temperature budget as a function of radius and height, but not a. I don't have another.
Yeah.
I don't think I have a horizontal cross section like this. But if you did potential temperature qualitatively, it would look the same.
Yeah.
It would just be a slightly different magnitude.
Yes.
So associated with this negative radial temperature gradient, which you get because you're warming the eye and not warming the area outside the eye, through thermal wind balance, this requires that the tangential winds decrease with height. That's one way of looking at why we have a decrease in height in the tangential winds in tropical cyclones. Or on the other hand, you can say that thermal wind balance requires that wherever the tangential winds decrease with height, the temperature must increase inwards. You can look at it from either perspective. Balance requires there to be a relationship between the radial temperature gradient, the TDR, and the vertical gradient of the tangential wind, dBdz. Because in tropical cyclones, we do have a decrease in the winds with height. This means that the temperature is generally warmest at the center of tropical cyclones, because UBDZ is negative, so UTDR must be negative, and so you'd have that